So the next chapter in the Resident Evil franchise is due to come out this May, and it looks pretty sick. You've got werewolves, creepy gothic mansions, 10-foot-tall mommy vampires. It looks like an amazing game.
So we finally meet.
I love you.
But with Resident Evil 8 coming closer over the horizon, I think it's a good idea to take a step back and think about what led us all here. Mainly how the franchise pulled itself back from the brink of absolute disaster and revitalized itself, all thanks to one little game that came out of nowhere and shook the series up like a snow globe. I'm talking about Resident Evil 7. Now before I get started talking about that game, let's talk about the Resident Evil IP for just a bit. Now everybody knows about Resident Evil, everybody, from young children to grandmas. It's a legend among video games and one of the big franchises that gets headlines whenever a new title is announced. The fan base is extremely loyal, and it even got enough hype to get an entire live-action movie franchise over here in the West, though it sucked ass and nobody likes it. Please don't comment that you actually like the Resident Evil movies. Just don't. My day's been bad enough as it is. Please don't. If you somehow have zero clue what Resident Evil is, even in passing, let me explain. Resident Evil is the biopunk action horror series created by Capcom back in the 1990s. Now, the beginning of the franchise is actually kind of a funny story. Back sometime in the late 1980s, if I remember right, 1989 specifically, there was a game on the Famicom called Sweet Home. It was an adaptation to a popular Japanese horror movie that was in theaters at the time. By the way, Sweet Home the movie is fucking trippy. Check it out if you can find a copy. It's insane. But instead of being some cheap cash-in garbage you would see angry video game nerd tear into pieces, Sweet Home laid the groundwork for a lot of features that became mainstays to the survival horror genre, mainly solving puzzles and managing your resources, all while trying not to get ripped to shreds by the bad boys hiding in the mansion you're trapped in. It was such a game changer that a shitload of classic survival horror games followed the formula Sweet Home thought up. Even stuff like QuickTime events showed up in Sweet Home. It was wild. Unfortunately, the game never released out west. It was exclusive to Japan, and still kinda is if you don't include ROMs with fan translations. Nevertheless, the exclusivity gave a bright young developer an idea. See, the head guy behind Sweet Home was Tokuro Fujiwara. He's the designer behind a lot of Capcom's lineup, everything from Ghost and Goblins to Mad World. Yeah, that's not a joke. See, Tokuro wanted to remake Sweet Home, probably to iron out ideas that the Famicom version introduced and give it a chance to reach a wider market. He tried multiple times to get the project off the ground. There were builds on the Super NES, then an attempt at a fully 3D FPS, now that a fancy new console just released, which was a massive jump in technology for video games, the PlayStation. Sadly, they lost the rights to use the movie as source material, so they had to find a way to turn everything they've already worked on into its own beast. After some refining, it was finally decided that the game would be third person with fixed camera angles, and instead of holding the reins himself, Fujiwara handed the leadership role over to a guy by the name of Shinji Mikami. Any reason as to why? Well, Mikami was a pussy. Fujiwara wanted to know what would frighten players, so he approached the guy that was apparently infamous in the office for being a scaredy cat, and in hindsight, this was a great idea. The first Resident Evil game was a smashing success, cheesy script and hilarious English dub aside.
Is this?
That's right. This is the ultimate life form. Tyrant! Chris? Stop it!
Players loved the tension and atmosphere the game set up. The Spencer Mansion is this large, intimidating location. All the deadly traps and weird puzzles, not even talking about the zombies or giant spiders. You hear this a lot, but it really is a character in itself. People fell in love with the lore, with Umbrella and Stars, and the characters most of all. Chris Redfield, Jill Valentine, Barry, Wesker, Rebecca. All of them are still franchise mainstays some 20 years later. While Sweet Home introduced a lot of popular ideas for survival horror, and most people consider Alone in the Dark to be the big game that brought survival horror into being its own genre, Resident Evil was the one that really took it mainstream. And with such a success of a first game came the inevitable, the sequels.
All right, that's far enough. Don't move! Don't move. No!
You had Resident Evil 2, which arguably became a larger pop culture icon than the first game. It was noticeably more action-focused, having been directed by Hideki Gunsight's locked, your already blocked Kamiya. There were more set pieces, a crazier story focusing on how the infamous infection that led to the Spencer Mansion incident escaped into a major population center. You had nastier enemies and a completely new cast. Leon Candy, the rookie cop stuck in the zombie-infested city on his first day. Claire Redfield, the younger sister to Chris, who goes to Raccoon City to find him after his disappearance. And Ada Wong, the mysterious mercenary that forever tempts Leon away from the true and honest path of the Redfield bloodline. There's also some memorable side characters, such as the Birkins, mainly Sherry Birkin, and I'd probably put more here, but the only game she was really in after this was 6. Still, Resident Evil 2 was massive, just like the first game, being one of the big PlayStation titles. Yeah, it's not a joke when I say that Resident Evil, when it was coming out, was just one after another in regards to taking the market, because after 2, you had 3, which had even more iconic shit. Jill Valentine came back from the first game, and you see the destruction of Raccoon City, and of course, Nemesis. Also, interesting story, because there is actually a very common misconception. They originally wanted Resident Evil 3 to be set on some kind of luxury ship, which is why a lot of people point to Resident Evil Revelations as sort of a tribute to the original plotline of what 3 was going to be, as it involves Jill on a luxury ship fighting monsters. 3 was completely different, as they wanted new characters, and sort of just moving on from what you've seen before with the other two games. It was kind of meant to be its own beast. Unfortunately, the deadline to have the game out before the PS2 released forced them to step back and readjust the plan, so it was scaled down to Raccoon City and featuring Jill. Also, there are some rumors and debate over which game was supposed to be the real sequel, Code Veronica or Resident Evil 3. You can understand the mix-up. Hell, CV started off as a direct port of Resident Evil 2 to the Sega Saturn, but the console just wasn't strong enough to handle it, and the port got canned. So instead, they decided to create the next game, specifically on Dreamcast, as sort of an apology to Sega fans they couldn't play to.
We're sorry. I'm deeply sorry. Sorry.
But RE3 is the true sequel to 2. CV was always planned as a spin-off since the beginning, though nobody could be blamed for buying into the urban legend since so much conflicting information was out there. Hell, if you think this is bad, don't even get me started on how the original build of RE4 turned into Devil May Cry. That's not a joke.
Let's rock.
But you can see the pattern here. Every game in the series up to this point has been a smashing success. Yeah, they've had stumbles, some features haven't aged the best, the voice acting was consistently wonky, and the side games were a mixed bag. Code Veronica had cool moments, but then you wanted to shove Steve dick first into a zombie's mouth.
He won't come. You'll just end up disappointed if you rely on others. Believe me, I know.
What was that all about?
Resident Evil 0 helped flesh out the character of Rebecca, but it created plot holes in the first game, and some of the fights were pure bullshit. I fucking hate Eliminators so much. But you also had some real gems with the side games. Outbreak was a really creative idea, focusing on fleshing out the world through sort of an anthology, where you play as a bunch of random civilians stuck in Raccoon City when the zombie apocalypse kicks off. It was really cool, and actually the first Resident Evil game to feature online co-op all the way back on the PS2. I like it. Fuck the haters. Just saying, Capcom, if you did an HD remaster, I would totally buy it. But then you also had the Revelations series, though that's more recent. Still, they feel more in line with classic Resident Evil than the main games that were coming out around the time these games were making the light of day. Were they incredible? No, but it gave good fan service with certain characters coming back after years of not showing up in any games. And then you also had the really bottom of the barrel stuff, like the rail shooters. I'm not even gonna talk about the ports to stuff like the DS, where it's like, no. Umbrella Chronicles and Darkseid Chronicles were retellings of events from Resident Evil canon. They're fun, but definitely fit more of an arcade than a console, but they're cool enough for a playthrough, inoffensive if you had to pin it down. But then you also had Resident Evil Dead Aim, and that one was That one was weird. A guy turned into a female tyrant. The plot was weird. Still, the franchise was going strong at this time. There was even a complete remake of the first game released on the GameCube. And it's the hypest thing ever. Play it. It's amazing. This isn't even an exaggeration. Fucking play Remake. It's really good. Between all of this, all the side games, and even animated movies, there was a game that came out that changed things. Really changed things. Resident Evil 4.
Where's everyone going? Bingo?
Let me be perfectly honest, I really like Resident Evil 4. It's a complete blast to play. The fights are fun as hell, the story is a complete cheeseball mess that knows exactly what it is, and the gameplay is still solid a full 16 years after the game came out. Just like Sweet Home before it, Resident Evil 4 kicked off a revitalization, only instead of to horror, it's to third-person action games. The over-the-shoulder shooting went on to be used by God knows how many other titles, and still is to this day. And RE4 is the game directly responsible for the creation of the Dead Space series, as it was originally being developed as a reboot to the System Shock series. Depending on your perspective, RE4 either helped create one of your favorite survival horror franchises out there, or helped kill it. That's where we get to the fun part. There's a split among Resident Evil fans, specifically over 4. Some see it as a kick-ass addition to the franchise, others see it as the start of the Dark Ages, and neither are really wrong here. Resident Evil 4 isn't a horror game, like, at all. It's an action game with horror elements. The classic formula you saw in games like Resident Evil 1, Silent Hill, Fatal Frame, that's gone. No more skulking around in an intimidating environment filled with monsters, desperately avoiding conflict while trying to solve puzzles. Instead, the gameplay loop is noticeably more conflict-focused. You want to fight enemies in this game. One, it's really fun to shoot them. There's plenty of impact and the guns sound great. Plus, you get ammo, items, and money from defeating enemies. There's no running past the Spanish cultist. You shoot him in the head with a shotgun and get $100 from it. Two, there are multiple points where you are directly forced to fight enemies. Either you're locked in a room or need to steal a key from a commander. There's a bunch of excuses that force you into shooting things. Three, the puzzles are really streamlined. Most involve solving a simple logic riddle, or finding a thing and combining it with another thing. There, those are your RE4 puzzles, and they mainly act as ways to give you some downtime between fights, because other than shooting dudes, you'll be hunting for treasure or tracking down key items. If you grew up on the older games, it can feel like an absolute insult. It's like a completely different game wearing the name of the franchise. RE4 is still really good. I personally think it's amazing, and it's aged like a fine wine in a lot of respects. There's a reason this game's been ported to more consoles than Skyrim, because it's that damn good. But fans could see that the series was changing, and for some, it wasn't in a way they wanted. Now, after Resident Evil 4 came the beginning of the Dark Times.
Eve of its appearance, 6 billion cries of agony will birth a new balance. Soon, even you will understand, Chris. One glimpse of my new world,
and it will all make perfect sense.
The early 2010s were a conflicting time for video games, mainly because of one titan of a series that came out of nowhere and kicked off one of the most exhausting trends in gaming history. Make it like Call of Duty. Around this time, the first Modern Warfare was dominating the market, and the sequel was due to come out any day, building on an already explosive hype market. This is when you saw a lot of franchises change. To put it simply, look at Fear 1 and compare it to Fear 2. One of them came out after Modern Warfare.
The dead man's name was Charles Haberger. I remember him. But are the memories mine or hers? It makes no difference. He deserved to die. They all deserve to die.
A lot of games tried to be these weird, militaristic Michael Bay theme park rides, and it damaged far more properties than it really should have. Resident Evil wasn't immune to this, sadly. The first big confirmation of it was Resident Evil 5. Now, 5 wasn't that bad. In fact, there's more than a few people that say 5 is a lot of fun, especially if you play it in co-op with your buddy, which is almost a necessity, because babysitting AI Sheva makes me want to put my head into an industrial press. It was a clear step away from the roots of Resident Evil. Evil. 4 was clearly an action game, but it at least pretended to be scary at points. 5 is so focused on looking cool that I can't see anybody even getting slightly uncomfortable playing this. It's fully an action game. Of course, action in Resident Evil isn't inherently a bad thing. The franchise has always had those elements. From the beginning, the protagonists have always been special forces badasses capable of taking down fucked up creatures with grenade launchers and shotguns. The fun was seeing these elite soldiers having to fight off monsters that are unlike anything they've seen before. But 5 took it a bit too far. You're not just fighting mutants in a zombie-infested city. You're capping infected mercenaries with guns, getting into car chases. I don't know about you, but I shouldn't be role-playing Black Hawk Down in a horror game. The set pieces are way more explosive. Even the boss battles focus more on exploiting a gimmick instead of being a tense mind game of managing resources and dealing damage. You outright use a space laser to blow up a tentacle monster. Cool in concept, but it feels weird. I guess a way to describe it for people not invested in the series is like this. Take Fallout. Let's go with New Vegas for this example. Now everyone knows a major aspect of Fallout is role-playing, building a character from scratch and playing out a set personality you've created for them. You can be a mysterious gunslinger, a doctor just trying to do the right thing, a psychopathic cannibal, all sorts of options. Though my personal favorite build is the drunken IRA Irishman. I don't care that it's been 300 years! Free and independent Ireland forever! But then you have Fallout 4, which really strips back on the role-playing. The quests are all linear, you can't have as much variation as previous games. Instead, it focuses on being some kind of looter-shooter in Minecraft.
The generators will power things through switches that require power, lights and other items, and then you run wires that connect them all. And again, it just works.
It's like everything that made the franchise popular and special was completely disregarded. That's how Resident Evil 5 can feel at times. Like they're ashamed of being a horror game. Now the setting, West Africa, is actually really cool. I wanted to see more about how the bad guys were exploiting the natives and experimenting on unknowing innocence. It's a creative setting with a lot of potential. Oh, never mind, guess it's racist to put games in Africa. Not like traditional tribes still exist to this day. And of course, an amoral bioweapon manufacturer would probably use them as test subjects due to their isolated nature. Yeah, they had to put Sheva in the game, a native African, because people freaked out and called it racist. Granted, she's a good character, and is pretty likable, actually. But still, this was the first piece of evidence of how stupid games journalists are, all the way back in 2009. So Resident Evil 5 was a bit too focused on the action, and looked like a major departure to what made Resident Evil special. Hopefully RE6 would fix that and we can go back to what made this series so great. Well, a single game foreshadowed the inevitable fate of the sixth entry, Operation Raccoon City, the clunky pseudo-tactical co-op game. All I can say about it is this: gunplay sucked, missions weren't worth a damn, and you didn't even remember this until I brought it up. It was a loosely connected series of shootouts, one that really wanted to push some multiplayer focus, with in-game invasions and competitive modes. It fell apart, and is still dead to this day. And nobody cares, unless you're one of those weirdos that played it with your friends. But Raccoon City was an omen, one that predicted the direction this franchise was heading down. Any attempt at horror was completely thrown out the window. Instead, multiplayer and big, expensive action movie moments ran the gambit. And when 6 came out, well, Resident Evil 6 kinda sucks.
You're right.
That's all I can say. It really kinda sucks. Resident Evil 4 and 5 had too much action for some people. Personally, I think RE6 has too much action for pretty much anybody. This game is a complete mess. The story is a disconnected ball of plot points that relies on you playing the 4 separate campaigns to get the full picture. It's not a bad idea. And in fact, some campaigns are pretty cool. I like Ada's and Jake's, even though... Yeah, I gotta talk about those people eventually. But the minute you play 1, you already know exactly what's going to happen. So you're stuck going through these absolute slogs trying to reach the ending. Seriously, you can guess what's going to happen the minute you see it. Hey, why is Ada wearing a different dress in this scene? Why is she evil? Think of the dumbest plot twist possible. Yeah, you got it. Now, Resident Evil 6 has cool ideas. There's an emphasis on co-op like with Resident Evil 5, but more streamlined and less of a hassle if you're playing alone. They took interesting directions with the characters. Seeing Chris as a broken mess obsessed with revenge was a cool idea. Then they paired him up with an absolute jobber who he has zero chemistry with, instead of, I don't know, Jill Valentine, the woman he's been platonic best friends with for 20 years. You could have had a cool dynamic where Jill is trying to shake some sense into Chris, who's too busy self-flagellating to get his shit together, but he's just one campaign. You also have Leon's, Ada, and Jake. Each one is a different perspective on the story. Chris is hunting down Ada after she kills his entire team. Leon is trying to find out who is spreading the horrific C virus across the globe, which resulted in the death of the President of the United States. Ada is just trying to figure out what the hell is going on and why a woman that looks like her is running around, and Jake is there too. Okay, Jake. Jake Mueller. Or if we're using his real name, Jake Wesker. Yeah, he's Wesker's kid. Turns out the Resident Evil Netflix show wasn't the first to bullshit a kid for Wesker, the violent sociopath that viewed himself as being above humanity. And it's not like he's just a dude and was born before his father did all of his evil shit with Umbrella. He kinda knows his dad is evil and still gets pissed when Chris admits he killed him. It's weird, and it's a plot point they never fleshed out, which honestly describes a lot of Resident Evil 6. At least with his campaign, you get Sherry Birkin back, and she grew up to be a badass cutie. Not gonna lie, she's pretty good. But the story being dumb isn't a death sentence. Plenty of Resident Evil games have dumb stories. The problems come from how it's told. You're thrust into an endless barrage of set pieces and action scenes. Leon's campaign especially is a complete clusterfuck. Here's a visual metaphor of what it's like to play Resident Evil 6.
Keep filling it up! It's not at the top yet! Keep filling it higher with booze! It's not there yet! Keep pouring, idiot! It's not filled up yet! Keep going! There's more room in the pint glass! Keep pouring!
It just never stops. Missions drag on and on, shoving bloated action scenes in your face without a single moment to breathe. RE6 is downright exhausting to play. There's barely enough time for characters to sit down and talk to each other before another set piece comes rolling in to throw them across the map. In comparison, let's look at Resident Evil 1. I'll go with the remake version because it's pretty. But look at how empty the mansion is. You walk slow and there's plenty of time to sink into the setting. You can read notes that flesh out the world at large. There's enough downtime to piece together what's going on in your mind. It's really interesting. Even RE2 had moments like that, 3 as well. Original 3, not Remake 3. Remake 3 is honestly kind of just as bad as RE6. The key is to get you used to a slower pace, then jack up the craziness. RE6 is just crazy from the beginning. Some people say that while RE6 is a bad horror game, it's at least a fun action game. I can't even really agree there. The missions go on for a long ass time. Each chapter is an hour each, and that's something that really grinds on you if you try to sit down and play through the game. It's clearly made for short sessions. You jump in, play a chapter with your buddy, jump out. Trying to marathon the whole thing burns you out fast. It's the only game in the franchise I actively had to take breaks for. In fact, it's the only one I've repeatedly tried to finish and just couldn't. It's just not that fun, even though it really tries hard to seem exciting. A lot of people consider this to be the black sheep of the franchise. It has some defenders that try to look at it for what it is instead of comparing it to the rest, but in my opinion, it's just way too flawed. It's like an endless drumline against your head. It never stops, it never slows down, and you just get numb to it after a bit. The worst part is that you had one final game that came out, and at the time of the release, burned people away from any hope that the franchise would ever go back to how it was. Umbrella Corps. Remember Operation Raccoon City? Capcom tried to remake it. And somehow it's even worse. At least ORC was a sequence of events that took you across a level. It felt like you were moving somewhere. Umbrella Corps is a glorified mercenaries mode, meaning you've got a compact map and you shoot mindless zombies for way too long. It's just not fun. This was Capcom's attempt to break into esports. And yeah, they openly admit it too. This isn't speculation. Plus, this came out when Overwatch was dominating the market. So we went from a cryptic survival game all about puzzle solving and managing resources to I want to be Overwatch. You can see how far this franchise has strayed. Hell, there was even a point when people were convinced Resident Evil was never coming back to its full glory. But then, 7 happened. Resident Evil 7 was a drastic redirection of the series. While every game post 4 pointed to a change in philosophy to become more action focused with gross monsters running around basically in the background, 7 was different, completely so. 7 is a horror game, a full blown survival horror game just like the classics before it. Inventory management? It's back. Puzzle solving? Yep. Purposely clunky gameplay to build tension as you desperately try to fight off enemies? Howdy. Resident Evil 7, subtitled Biohazard as a nod to the franchise's alternate title in Japan, was a full shakeup to the bad habits Capcom was letting sink in. Instead of a big city that explodes into fire and rocks like with 6, instead you are stuck in an isolated family house somewhere in buttfuck Louisiana. You're not a special forces army man anymore, you're just a dude who has no clue what's going on. There are no anime fights with mutant Englishmen anymore, or evil clones. You're being chased by homicidal rednecks and mold zombies for the whole game. Now, it's really easy to compare the direction 7 went to the hide-and-seek horror genre that was big around this time in the mid-2010s. Stuff like Amnesia, The Dark Descent, Outlast, and Soma. Games where the emphasis is to hide from a threat instead of fight. To put it bluntly, this trend was awful, in my opinion. I never liked it, even when the games were good. It felt cheap, like the developers were intentionally leaving out an entire chunk of gameplay for the sake of creating tension. Yeah, it worked for something like Amnesia, where the monsters are clearly abominations of meat and stitches, or outright invisible and could kill you in seconds, so you could see why no rational person would think it would even be possible to defend yourself. Then you have a game like Outlast, where it's just a bunch of dudes. Sure, they're crazy, and one of them is super big, but they're still just dudes. Hell, the sequel is even more egregious. The bad guys in that are literally just farmers. The main antagonist is an old lady with a scythe. Pick up a weapon. You fucking idiot, pick up a weapon, pick up a pitchfork. It just frustrates me. I never find crap like this scary. It feels like the game itself is saying, no, you can't do that. Isn't it scary how you can't fight? It's scary. The bad guy's so strong. He's so scary and strong. No. No, it's not. This is where Resident Evil 7 diverged from the pack, but I'll explain it down the line. For now, I'm going to explain just the opening hour to the game. Resident Evil 7 has a really simple setup. This is going to involve mild spoilers, which I've tried to avoid mostly in a lot of the explanations of the previous titles, mainly because each game in and of itself is worthy of a full video, but I feel like if I did that, I'd just become a discount version of Sphere Hunter. Still, you understand why I'm trying to keep this as opaque as I can, so people that want to jump into the series won't know everything right off the bat. But Resident Evil 7's intro does more than enough to tell you exactly what kind of game it's going to be. This won't involve anything with the ending, so you don't have to worry there, but if you want to jump into the game completely blind, be warned.
Hello?
Hey, it's Ethan.
Oh, hey. You alright? You just disappeared the other night.
Yeah, no, I'm good. I'm good. It's Mia. She's not dead, she's alive. She's back.
You play as Ethan Winters, an average Joe who receives a mysterious message from your wife Mia, who's been missing for 3 years now. Mia says she's okay and to meet her somewhere in rural Louisiana. Ethan goes to try and find her and almost immediately sees that it was a fucking awful idea. Not exactly sure when it would hit him, probably between seeing the creepy house behind the locked gate or the meat door. Ethan pushes forward and enters the house, and is practically assaulted with every red flag in the book, from the building being seemingly abandoned to outright dead bodies in the basement. But Ethan is a strong boy, so he keeps going to try and save his wife. You might ask why he doesn't just turn back and call the police. I don't really have a point here, but ironically that would actually make the situation worse when you get further in the story. Still, the beginning sets up Ethan as a desperate husband trying to find his wife. You might think the whole plot is him trying to track her down, similar to how another survival horror title tied to a beloved franchise plays out. Well, the interesting thing is that he finds her. You find Mia just a few minutes into the game, and it's when you see her that you realize she's acting a bit different from what you would think.
Thank God I found you. It's me. It's Ethan.
Ethan? Ethan?
Are you all right?
You shouldn't be here.
What do you mean? You contacted me.
No, I wouldn't. Did I? Did anyone see you? Did he see you?
Hey, who else is here? What the hell's going on?
Daddy's coming. We need to go.
Daddy?
We need to go now!
Yeah, Mia is kinda quirky. She's rambling about how she didn't actually send you a message and that it was a bad idea for you to come and get her. It's a slow but steady buildup that something is really wrong here. Still, Ethan and Mia try to find an exit. Then she suddenly disappears.
No, leave me alone!
Mia?
Ethan rushes to try and find her again after it sounds like someone literally just burst through the wall and took her, but she's gone. Now you're completely alone, in a creepy house that, to the best of your knowledge, is owned by an active kidnapper and possible serial killer. You better answer the phone. Oh great, no service. Well, I'm sure I'll be fine. Oh hey, the door to the basement is open again. Yeah, it turns out Mia is a spooky monster lady. She tries to violently kill you all while desperately fighting to gain control of herself again. All to end with her chucking you through the wall. You've got no choice. She's gonna keep coming after you. Grab the hatchet and introduce her to the concept of true gender equality. Ethan is just a guy, but he's unafraid to throw down, so we're immediately off to a good start here. The phone starts ringing out of nowhere, even though it was just a dial tone before. The voice on the phone calls you a stupid idiot for coming to this madhouse, and they're not wrong. This adventure isn't very fun. You try to move on ahead, and wait, what happened to Mia's body? Eh, who cares, it's fine, she's dead. Still, you push forward, and just as you think you're finally alone again, Mia comes back. Turns out she's alive. Well, that's good, hopefully she's not mad about the- Never mind, she's extremely mad.
You shouldn't have done that! It's fucking hers!
Mia impales your hand with a screwdriver, and Ethan has to desperately rip the thing out of the wall as his mutated wife grabs a chainsaw. Unfortunately, you're not fast enough, and Ethan gets the Ash Williams treatment. While all of this crazy shit is going down, you have to keep yourself together, grab your hand, and run for the attic. There you find your saving grace, a handgun. Now you have some kind of chance to fight off your monster wife. Well, there's a mini boss fight where you have to desperately plug bullets into her head until she stops moving. It's a complete nightmare. She rushes at you with the chainsaw over and over again. Finally, she goes down, and Ethan tries to get the fuck out of Dodge. Then a scary Cajun man knocks you unconscious.
Welcome to the family, son.
This is the prologue to the game. After this, you meet the antagonist to the story, the Bakers.
Who are all you people? Where's Mia?
Eat it. It's good.
Dumb son of a bitch wasn't no good if it hit him.
Yes.
Not to worry, Margaret.
Hit boy's got to eat. He got to have his supper. Come here, boy. Let's do this.
Shit, he's not eating it, Jack! He's not eating
it! Shut the hell up, Marguerite!
Eat that for him!
Get the hell out of here!
You're a son of a bitch! Oh, I can't believe it, you son of a bitch! He's not eating it! He's not eating it!
This was supposed to be a very special feast.
You might have noticed a lot of influences on the story already. Evil Dead, Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Hills Have Eyes. RE7 is heavily inspired by Grindhouse Horror. While all the legacy characters to the franchise have fun animu adventures, Ethan doesn't get that luxury. Leon gets to save the president's daughter from an evil cult. Ethan gets tortured by mutant cannibals. And the introduction helps set the stage of the story. Resident Evil 7 is a game willing to take its time, to let you get comfortable with what you think you know. That first creep onto the baker's property as you're skulking through the woods and finally get down into the basement to try to track down Mia. It goes on for a bit, then it rips the curtain open and completely ramps things up, and it still keeps it self-contained to the setting. Half the house doesn't explode in the opening hours to Resident Evil 7. Instead, it's nastier, more personal. It's more grotesque by focusing on the consequences of it happening to a single human being, instead of trying to just cake the entire world in zombie virus and, yeah, just go way too overboard with it. And really, the high point of the game are the villains. The Bakers are a terrifying group of antagonists. They're not amoral scientists with delusions of grandeur. They're sadistic redneck serial killers that are completely psychotic. Still, they're intelligent and capable of making plans. And this is where the gameplay helps cement how frightening they are. Some argue that putting guns in a horror game removes all tension, that now you have a way of defending yourself, you no longer feel as vulnerable as when you were completely exposed. I very much disagree with that. It comes down to the subjective nature of horror in general. What frightens one person won't scare another. But I feel like 7 still manages to keep you feeling vulnerable for a large chunk of the game, and it comes down to just two scenes.
Do I have your attention, boy? You're about to see some wonderful.
Fuck!
A few minutes later.
Heck of a thing, man. It sure shit beats the hell out of dying.
Yeah, shooting the Bakers doesn't stop them. In fact, it's just a waste of bullets. Instead of telling you that they are scary and you can't fight back because of it, the game lets you learn the hard way. These guys are nearly indestructible. You already had a hint of it with Mia, where she was able to shrug off a hatchet wound in multiple 45 rounds. But Jack Baker confirms it. A gun won't save you here. Sure, it'll help, but you need to be way smarter if you want to stay alive. Immediately, the tension in the game is jacked up. Now you're not avoiding the Bakers because the game told you to, and it's the only way to avoid a game over. You're doing it because you've tried other options and it just doesn't work. They'll keep chasing you. You have to take things slowly, quietly, and try to keep yourself from getting caught. If they get you, you have to spend powerful healing items to keep yourself alive. Essentially, it comes down to the principle of show, don't tell. It doesn't have to tell you you're not a fighter, therefore it's scary. No, Resident Evil 7 lets you be a fighter. You can try to defend yourself, but it shows you that it's really not gonna play out the way you think it will. You're not gonna be an overpowered badass that takes him out with a few headshots and moves on with your day. The dude's gonna get back up. He'll keep chasing you. All you did was waste resources on a short-term solution. I guess the best way to describe it is it's the difference between a bad stealth section in a game and something like Thief. A bad stealth section instantly fails you if you get caught, nothing else, just a game over. While a game like Thief punishes you for being caught by showing you the consequences. You get swarmed by guards. Your melee combat is shitty so you can't fight them off. Then you die. The gameplay reinforces that you use the systems given to not get caught in the first place. Showing the consequences to failure is way better than just smash cutting to a game over. Granted, RE7 was kinda guilty of that with the DLC, but in all fairness, that was one segment of banned footage, and it was mainly there to flesh out the Bakers as characters so you feel more bad about everything that happens in the story. But the main game was more in line with what I'm talking about. Plus, the DLC was pretty short, so it wasn't like you were going through a massive chunk of the section just to get thrown into a game over and have to restart. Pedantic excuses aside, the entire reason this point exists is because this subtle distinction between being able to fight and fail adds a new layer to the horror. Why do you think people still enjoy Alien Isolation? Feeling the clunkiness of the combat and seeing the bullets plink off the xenomorph shows you how vulnerable you truly are. You, the player, naturally drift to avoiding conflict because you know it's the best possible solution to the problem. Instead, you're allowed to come up with other ideas to distract the xenomorph, to try to get through it using what you're given. It lets you fuck up and see what happens. The big point is that instead of simply telling you to hide in a corner and turn away from the monster, which gets very, very repetitive once you do it a few times, Resident Evil 7 instead focused more on giving a claustrophobic vibe to the entire ordeal. Yeah, you can run past the Bakers at points, but you're also stuck in a tiny house with them. Staying in one area is the exact opposite solution to the problem. You have to be smarter, you have to know how to slip past them. It adds another layer behind the hide and seek, because honestly, I'm really sick to death of that subgenre and I do not miss it. Also, I just wanted an excuse to talk about Thief. I've been playing Thief 2 again recently and it's fun, it's a lot of fun.
Fucking slaves!
Now, is Resident Evil 7 perfect? No. The ending of the game devolves into the action set piece bonanza that plagues the more modern titles. Granted, it has a lot more build up to justify the set pieces, and it has every right to go crazy for the finale, but the problem comes from the main fodder enemies that you're fighting in pretty much every mode, from the campaign to the DLC expansions, the Molded. Now, the Molded, on paper, are really cool. They're essentially an amalgamation of flesh and spores holding themselves together. They have all sorts of tiny details, like seeing the skeleton hidden deep inside the monster when they tear themselves off the walls. But the design of the Molded are just boring. They're not exciting to fight. The parasites have more personality. Zombies are just a far more universally appealing creature. And mutant animals were, at the very least, fast-paced. The Molded are slow, and don't really do anything than grab and bite you. Way to kill them? Shoot them in the head, and nothing else. They're less designed zombies. And the thing is, the first half of the game clearly treats them as a backdrop. The bakers are the real threat and take the majority of your focus. Most of the Molded do is destroy the sense of security you developed when you entered an area they couldn't go into, so you never feel safe. Problem is that as the game goes on and the bakers stop being relevant to the story, they needed something to replace them, so the jobber mold things become more of an emphasis. The DLC also especially worsened the problem, where fighting the Molded end up becoming the main thing you do. Not a hero, one of the sections of banned footage, and End of Zoe. End of Zoe at least had fun with it, where you played as a backwoods retired boxer living in the bayou. Every combat encounter is beating the shit out of the mold zombies with your bare hands, it's nuts. Plus you suplex a swamp man.
Here we go! What's wrong?
Maybe that's why 8 is gonna make you fight vampires and werewolves. They're more exciting than just mold. But all in all, Resident Evil 7 at least took a big step in the right direction. It slowed things down, let you get immersed into the world it wanted to build, and it married the new age of horror games with the classic survival horror the series was famous for. Capcom clearly learned how much people like this aspect to Resident Evil. 2 Remake was a love letter to the original game that helped kick off the success of their new franchise, and while 3 Remake was a misstep that was not as good as what people were hoping for, 8 at least looks like a continuation to the style 7 introduced. It's clearly a tribute to classic gothic horror instead of grindhouse, and I'm excited to see how they do it. Resident Evil is a series that walks a fine line between full-blown action and horror. The best games balance the elements together, not going too far in one direction. We've already seen what happens when the series forgets this lesson, but thankfully it was pulled from the brink. The last few years showed a new momentum for the franchise. Hopefully they can keep it going, but who knows what the future holds. Still, Resident Evil is a great series, and I highly recommend you all to check it out. You won't regret it. Until next time, please remember to like, comment, and subscribe. See you guys. The art designers knew exactly what they were doing with the vampire MILF. They knew weirdos like me would pre-order 50 deluxe editions. Help, my bank won't let me buy anymore. I would like to thank my generous subscribe star donators. Your appreciation is much appreciated. LT, Spectre189, Bruva Bunglow, Drew Kasinger, William Thomas Benoit, Jojo Wyatt, Julian Foster, Mabuta Anon, Valkyra, Alchemical, Sordid Sentinel, Ogierd Rabenda, JaegerBomb2, Kafka's Bug, Zell, Bottled Titty Milk, Bridge Badger, Anthony Paletta, War Crime Enthusiast, Heat Signature, Quisp Heavy Sack Fratelli, Gobbin Logan, Shrimp Cake, Matthew Thompson, Joshua M. Howard, Sexy Demon Horse, Bost, Crumb, The False Knight, Munat, Hand Rubbing Merchant, Epistemological, Cream Pie Kohai, Sir Atlich, AMD Blue, Mr. Cool Gamer, and Lucas Stolas Enjoyer. Your appreciation is much appreciated, friends. Have a good one.